Welcome. I'm recording this voiceover before even starting the game. This video will be a live commentary with minor editing. As such, I will be playing, responding, and thinking without a script. I will also be theorizing and exploring at my whim. This video may be long because of that. On that note, the theorizing I will be doing will likely not be very thought out. So don't take my impromptu hypotheses to be true. They're probably not, and I might be an idiot. I only know what I've seen in screenshot Saturdays, so not everything in Wrath will be a surprise. However, Heresy in its entirety eludes me. Anyway, sit back, enjoy the show, and I hope I don't get too upset. Oh, and spoilers, obviously. You all ready? Let's go. Oh my god. That's cool. There's a way to get up there. There we go. Oh god. Very interesting. That's a broken one. Oh dear. Come here, you. Ah, damn it. That might have been a little overkill on that stray. Oh, I know these things. I see. What the fuck? And they don't stop coming, and they don't stop coming. Oh, bastard. Sit that ass down. Of course. Don't touch any water. What? Okay. I remember this. I remember seeing the picture. Can you see the bodies of the people? Ouch. I got that too. Well, this water rushing by while I'm heading forward is making me pretty woozy. Oh shit. I know this. There we go. Fuck that. Perfect.
The lore.
Excerpt from Ferryman's Diary. Some calamity has struck the mortal world. What was once the River Styx has now grown into an unfathomable ocean. A million weeping souls pouring in each day that the shores can barely contain. A tearful tide spilling over at each end, bow to stern, crying for mercy, begging for safe passage. But not all souls can pay, and these old hands can only take so many coins. Then one day, the current shifted, wave after wave, for minutes on end of millions, billions, as though the throat of the world was cut wide and the head wrenched back to speed the pour. I didn't have time to react. The weariness from my ceaseless work claimed me, and I slipped beneath the roiling sea, into the depths of the ocean Styx. My fate sealed by the crushing masses of endless bodies. Very interesting. So the ferryman was something. I don't think he's a demon. It. I don't think it's a demon. I don't know if it's a husk either. Maybe an angel? I'm not sure. Possibly an angel. Because the ferryman is a humanoid entity. So what happened was, this was probably the robot uprising, or whatever caused the extinction of humanity, where it was the river Styx became the ocean. The current shifted wave after wave for minutes on end. And then something worse happened. So, they were already dying bad. And then it got worse. And then the ferryman fell into the ocean. Well, we fight him, so he came back? Or maybe this is the bottom of the ocean. I hear it. I know where it is. There you are. You can't hide from me. Very interesting. There's my boy Gabby. Oh dear. Street cleaners. Fuck you. Ha! Got him, little bitch. Oh god. I'm out. Damn. I'm not doing this very well today. bitch. You can have this back. Bigger than I thought. Wait, I'm stupid. What? We've been tricked. We've been bamboozled. That's what I thought would happen. My God, this thing is huge. It's gotta be something back here. Oh yeah. Let's go. Yo, douchebag, I'm on your ship. Tithings. Oh! I changed my mind. Come on, little one. god. What if I do it again? I changed my mind about changing my mind. Your funeral, bud! Was really cool. Don't fight the ferryman. Yeah, there we go. I knew there would be a reference to that somehow. That was really cool. Okay. Let me look at the lore first. Oh, I heard that there's info now. Oh, man. A weapon created during the final war for medium to long distance combat. Uses electric pulses to fire microscopic pieces of metal at incredibly high speeds. Weapons that use this technology have been dubbed electric guns, and it quickly became the new standard, replacing bullet guns. Due to still requiring a microscopic projectile, its ammo is not actually infinite, but it would take weeks of non-stop firing to run out, and refilling is just as easy as scraping some flakes from scrap metal or even the gun's surface. In fact, a rough, uneven surface from scraping flakes is considered a point of pride for wielders of electric guns, as it shows the weapon has been reliable and used for a long time. Many users even shave off flakes just for this reason, rather than for actual ammunition, making unflaked electric weapons an outlier. Although an electric gun requires some time to recharge its battery between shots, the revolver-style design bypasses that issue by including a multi-battery cylinder that rotates after each shot, allowing each battery time to charge without slowing down the fire rate. A common modification is to allow the charges of all batteries to be released simultaneously for greater power, although this requires a longer recharge time. Okay, this is just strategy, not lore. Here we go. This is the shotgun. An experimental close-range weapon that uses hyper-concentrated heat as its projectiles. After each shot, the shotgun must be opened to allow its heat-generating cores to vent excess heat, stopping them from melting or exploding. This process is largely automated, requiring little more from the user than the flick of a wrist. In case of a core failure, the pump can be used as a manual heat-building mechanism. This process has been simplified via a small button near the grip that pumps the shotgun without requiring physical force from the user. Oh, that's why. That's how V1 can do it. Though its ease of use has also greatly increased the reported amount of misfires from users pumping too much heat into a single shot. Heat weapons never caught on as much as electric weapons due to their volatile nature and strict cooling requirements, but unlike electric weapons, they don't require a separate projectile, making their ammunition truly infinite, rather than just practically infinite. Okay, okay. So what can I get about the nail gun? A combination of parts from an industrial nail gun and an old bullet gun. Most likely engineered by a machine that was built for construction work, as all machines, even those not built for war, had to learn to fend for themselves after the extinction of mankind. Bullet guns were largely abandoned after the invention of infinite ammunition systems such as electric weapons and heat weapons, largely due to how cheaper not having to buy ammunition for large-scale armors becomes over time. Although the original ammunition system made it useless and largely abandoned, this gun was still excellently designed and built, and with some retrofitting of parts from an industrial nail gun, it has become a rapid-fire projectile weapon with practically infinite metal ammunition. Although it is to be expected from an improvised weapon, though, its design is far from perfect. As the nail regeneration system was not designed to work at such a high rate, it's liable to overheat if a hard rate limit isn't set on it, although some variants have opted for built-in heat sinks. Huh, that's cool. What about the saw cannon? Do we not get anything for the saw cannon? Or the saw blade launcher? Oh, that's sad. Well, we found this in Lust, so... Let's see. This industrial tool was one of the earliest uses for the technology that eventually became electric guns. Originally meant as a handheld generator, allowing for an easy way to generate electricity for a temporary relocation, such as encampments during wars or expeditions. As with most similar industrial tools, once mankind fell, it was repurposed as a weapon by the machine that wielded it, turning it from a lower voltage constant output into a single extremely high burst of energy that requires a long recharge time between shots. Although a risky weapon, since its recharge time is so long, the real cannon's power makes it a worthy tool to wield, especially for someone carrying multiple weapons that they can use while the rail cannon's battery charges. Well, isn't it fortunate that I happen to be one such machine? Very cool. Oh, I can change the skins. That's right. Well, of course, I'm going to choose the Magnum. Oh my god. Yo! There, you happy? That's really cool. Okay, okay. I like that. I like that a lot. Yeah. Okay. Let's look at enemies. Here we go. One of the many war machines. This is the century. One of the many war machines created during the final war. Although there were attempts to find new purpose for them during the new peace, their streamlined design made them unable to be repurposed until the start of the Hell expeditions. Their extremely powerful legs and feet allow them to dig into the ground, making them immovable by most forces, and allowing them to easily line up any shot without interruption. Despite their size, they were built to be extremely light, which, when combined with the power of their legs, allows them to move at extremely fast speeds. Such power and lightness have made their legs one of the most sought-after parts by scrapheads. Like Swords Machine. Swords Machine has those legs, I think. Maybe not the hydraulics in the back. Most machines will only render a simplified approximation of their visual surroundings for faster processing speed.
Whoa, bro.
But Sentries use full renders instead, giving them perfect accuracy even over extremely long distances. That's why this game looks like a...
Oh my god, bro, that's amazing.
So it's canon. I remember that posited in the Ultrakill Discord. So it's canon now. That's really cool. Okay, okay. So this is a demon. Oh my god. Although they can easily be mistaken of divine origin, idols were created using the same process as other demons. Unlike their larger kin, their shells were too small to contain a useful amount of hell mass, creating life, but leaving it unable to move or act. The idols did not originally look divine, but were painstakingly carved to such shapes by ferrymen who collected them during their travels across the layers of hell. This was done as both an act of compassion and a tribute to the angels, particularly Gabriel, whom ferrymen believed to have similarly granted them mercy. Close proximity to a ferryman's holy cloth during the long and arduous carving process caused its holy power to seep into them, allowing them to continue the chain of compassion by protecting others from physical harm. It is fortunate for them that Gabriel... It's actually pronounced Gabriel. It is fortunate for them that Gabriel is the only angel of heaven's higher order to watch over hell, since if the council had found out about such beings, they would have been labeled as perversions of the divine form in order to be destroyed by the ferryman who so lovingly granted them a chance at life. Huh. So they didn't look like that. They were carved that way. But I thought they had fleshy, meaty interiors. Did the stone grow around them after they were carved? Huh. Okay, so that... Wait, where's the ferryman? I beat him, right? Where is he? Oh my god, I could be any one of these. Is it a demon? Or an angel? That one's probably, Gabriel Part 2. Oh well, we'll see. Let's get on with it. Oh god. Wow, I suck. Come here! This is very interesting. Doing so good. Spent too much time reading. So presumably this level is going to be the longest in the entire game. Loving this music. There it is. Oh man. We were so hyped for that. Oh yeah. I knew there was something behind here. Oh man. Housekeeping! Housekeeping! Go away, please! Go away! Housekeeping! I don't think that's supposed to clip into the wall like so. Oh man. Not on my watch. A considerably redder paint job indeed.
The mind must rest, lest you squander one of the Lord's creations. Be not afraid, sinner. Your God shows goodness in you, plentiful indeed. The heart is willing, but the body must rest, lest you squander one of the Lord's creations. Be not afraid, sinner. Your devotion to God shows goodness in you, plentiful indeed. The heart is willing, but the body must rest, lest you squander one of the Lord's creations.
Accurate, my ass. Come here. There you go. Oh, that's no bueno. Oh God. There goes the ship.
Oh, whoa, bro. Oh my God.
Oh my God. Hank. Hank. Where's the skull? Why? Okay, we're not putting the skull there. Damn it. son of a bitch. Oh, that feels amazing. Come on. Damn it. I did not mean to do that. That's what this was here for. Rocket jumping, let's go! Oh, we've crashed already. Oh. Was really cool. Don't touch any water. How the... I guess I'll figure it out. Oh, Jesus, Lord in heaven. Well. How is this not shorting out? Well, let's look at this then, shall we? Freeze frame! Another weapon that used to be an industrial tool, as it's visible from it and the rail cannon's more vibrant color schemes compared to guns such as the revolver, shotgun, and the nail gun, which uses a bullet weapon as its base. As with most advanced technologies, it was originally created for use in war, as its explosive generating mechanism was extremely fast at digging trenches, destroying obstacles, or resupplying explosive weapons. However, this tool itself could not be used as a launcher. Early models doubled as weapons, but including the systems for triggering the explosives often caused accidental chemical reactions during their generation process, detonating the explosives before they had been completed. Since then, the process has been split in two, between the generating device and the separate rocket launcher, where the explosive generator builds the rest of the rocket and the rocket launcher applies the triggering mechanism. As machines rarely have the luxury of cooperation due to sharing blood with others, being seen as a waste, the machine that created this weapon instead modified the generation process to work with just a single user and repurposed parts from a jackhammer for launching the projectile. Instead of using a normal explosion triggering mechanism, the rockets instead used the blood of the target to complete the chemical reaction, making the generation process safe, although the weapon is more difficult to use as it requires direct hits to cause damage. The skill required for effective use makes it daunting, though its power more than makes up for it, and many of its wielders specifically chose to use it as a symbol of their skill at marksmanship. Huh. You can pull the rockets back towards you? Oh my god. That's really cool. How the hell is this gonna work? Oh. Ugh. Oh, that looks like a weak spot. Come on. Bam.
explosion!
Oh, Jesus. Well, I can tell you now, there was no city of dice. Okay, so what was that? Unlike most demons, the Leviathan is not formed from genetic hellmass, but instead from the bodies of the Sullen, a name used for those in the Ocean Styx who have given up fighting for air, and instead lay at the bottom of the ocean, drowning eternally. The Sullen, in their motionless, were eventually fused together by the same force that created the other demons, becoming the biblical Leviathan, an abomination prophesied to be at the end of the world. The heart, which houses the souls of the Sullen in endless anguish as their flesh, veins, and nerves writhe and mutate, attempted to escape its body, but Gabriel struck it down with his divine spears, pinning it back onto its head, unable to move. Although the world ended, the Leviathan remains trapped in the Ocean Styx, growing ever longer as more of Wrath's sinners gave up and sink to the bottom. Interesting. Then where's the ferryman? Oh, there's the ferryman. He's a husk. Ferrymen are rare husks whose powerful bodies, trained skills, and blind faith have granted them the chance of becoming the transporters of souls between the layers of hell. They have each been given a holy cloth by heaven as a symbol of their devotion to God's order, which they wear over their bodies to hide the human form that they've grown to despise as a reminder of their sins in life stopping them from becoming angels. Due to the holy power emanating from the cloth, Ferryman's skeletal bodies have slowly been colored bright and radiant, and their skulls have long enough latent energy to open up gates that otherwise stop husks from exiting their places of torment. Each ferry can only have one ferryman at a time, so when a new ferryman is formed, it will fight each other to the death in order to take their place and inherit their cloth. The loser's skull is taken as a trophy and used to grant the winner passage across the layers in order to transport the souls of the damned to their destinations. Ferrymen will often use the knowledge from their past life to improve their ferries, growing past the need for oars, which are now used by ferrymen only as weapons. As the influx of souls has As the influx of souls has ended with the death of mankind, the ferrymen have lost their purpose and now wander around aimlessly, hoping that the angels would grant them passage into heaven, despite Gabriel being the only one who cares about their efforts. So Hank is a ferryman. All of those blue skulls, all the red ones maybe, they were ferrymen. Strategy. Test. No shit. Okay. That's cool. Very interesting. Okay. So then that has to be Gabriel. target prioritization. Oh, man. That's gonna be a doozy, isn't it? Okay. I have never seen Wrath or Heresy before. So this is gonna be my first look. Swords machine! He returns! Jesus. He returns again! This is very hell-like. See that shit? See the shit, Shinji? Where you at? Ouch. This is awesome. Oh, that sounds awesome. Bring it! So many swords machines. Come on, buddy. Oh, God. Don't worry, I got this. I don't got this. This is awesome. All right, I forgot. This reminds me of, this reminds me of that, thing, that one map in Dusk, where you're up really high. You guys know that? Oh god. How are you still alive? I see you. Oh, hello. I don't know if that was worth it.
Machine, I know you're here. I can smell the insolent stench of your blood-stained hands. I await you down below.
Yeah, I'll kick your ass too. Round two.
Come to me.
Oh. Oh god. Don't worry, I got this. This retard, he's stuck.
Oh my god. Machine! Come on, Gabriel. Let's do this.
Limbo. Lust. All gone. With gluttony soon to follow. Your kinds know nothing but hunger. Purged all life on the upper layers, and yet they remain unsatiated. As to you. You've taken everything from me, machine. And now, all that remains is perfect hatred.
Is there now? Come on, Gabriel.
Machine, I will cut you down. Break you apart, splay the gore of your profane form across the stars! I will grind you down until the very sparks cry for mercy! My hands shall relish ending you here and now!
You need new moves, buddy. I already know this. Okay, well, maybe use a little.
You need more power.
I'll get you one of these days.
Time to right my wrong.
Oh, son of a bitch. I bet you won't give me a third time. I bet you won't give me a fourth time. God damn. It's that hard damage. The hard damage, Mrs. Lee. Well, lucky for you, I can respawn. Oh. Don't worry, I'll get there.
You're just getting rusty, machine.
Oh, damn. Wait, I need to start parrying. Wait, let's see. Wait, I already know this.
You need more power. Is this what I lost to?
Oh, I can't. Oh, got that bitch. Oh, Nelly partner. Oh,
ho, ho. What is this feeling?
Come on, I need to learn how to parry you. I can't parry that. I can do that, though. Get it one of these days. This hurts.
You're getting rusty, machine.
Mayhaps.
Time to think. We will meet again, machine. May your woes be managed.
That is not what I expected. Huh. Well. Very interesting. Hit Gabriel into the ceiling. Huh. Silence. Introspection. How many had he killed? Had he ever thought to count? How much cruelty did he embody? And to what end? How many did he condemn to hell? And who did it benefit? Two defeats at the hand of the machine has changed, Gabriel. The world of once supposed will of God was now shattered, and only he was left to put the pieces back together. They collected before the light of a dying fire that fresh fuel couldn't sustain. This new light showing the truth to Gabriel. The pieces never fit together to begin with. The supposed council of the people who boasted a god that wasn't there. Gone. Vanished. The council still chased after the light of God's fire, the memory of its words and will grown twisted and warped, with the rest of the aimless masses of heaven to follow their footsteps. The angels still act in the Father's name, but his kingdom has changed. Now the fire was dying, sputtering out as the heat failed to gain purchase. Gabriel looked upon the embers with a perfect clarity. He drew his blade and held it in contrast to the dying light. In its reflection, he saw a weapon born. Shit. In his reflection. God damn it. In its reflection, he saw a weapon reborn, no longer wielded by the will of another, but his own. He knew words alone would never sway the masses. He chose to do something drastic. Death stains the auditorium. The littered corpses of the once mighty council now strewn against its surfaces, their last gasps of light dripping down the dissident blade of Gabriel's sword. The last counselor, now backed up to a wall, scrambles for words between panicked breaths as death approaches with measured steps. Wait! You can't do this! Our status forbids it! This is treason, heresy, murder! Wield the supreme authority! Our law commands you! You command nothing. Your words hold no power over me or anyone else, lest you truly believe you can talk my blade back into its sheath. But the people are on our side! The citizens of heaven know that we are just! The masses know only follow you out of fear and desperation. I will show them there is nothing to be afraid of, for there is no species, no origin, vested rank, or holy status that will stop the sharp edge of a sword. We all bleed the same blood, and the cushions of your thrones have made you weak and impotent. Please, Gabriel, see reason. The council follows the will of the Father. You seek to go against our creed? Face it, brother. God is dead. The fire is gone. You are chasing phantoms.
Gabriel's silhouette now towers over the counselor. His shadow casts upon a soon lifeless corpse. He raises his sword for the final cut, as the crying mess on the floor stammers its last, final, feeble argument.
But the Father's light! Without me, you cannot hope to reconnect with it. If you kill me, you'll be dead in a matter of hours.
I know.
A clean, silent cut glides through the counselor's neck, severing his spine with elegance and ease. His head falls onto the marble floor, the rest of his body following soon after. Bereft of status, but brimming with purpose, Gabriel gave a final message to the angels amassed at the gates of the auditorium before leaving heaven for the very last time. His arms outstretched, without a word, the people saw. In the silence, the message rang out to the far ends of the cosmos.
Oh, man! Oh, my God! That did not go the way I expected it to go. Oh, my God. Wow. Wait, I need to go back. Okay, I'll finish that later. Sandbox, yeah. Let's see. There we go.
Gabriel, apostle of hate. Wait, apostate. Having twice clashed with the machine and lost, Gabriel realized that he had been mistaken. The strong fire that burned inside him was not hatred at all, but passion. Gabriel had never before known the joy of a struggle, of coming face to face with an opponent of equal or greater measure. Though he had lost twice, each loss only further grew his desire to overcome. Up until now, he had only done what was expected of him. But now for the first time, he had found something that he himself wanted. Not even the fast encroaching end of hell mattered to him anymore. Still, having come to realize the horrors he had committed in God's name, he felt a great guilt. Though he could not undo what he had done, Gabriel knew he had to make things right, and headed to hell for the last time.
Well, okay. Okay. So, okay. So we can wait here. While I theorize. So what I'm thinking is, well, let me talk about what actually happened. He headed for hell for the last time. Was that the last time? Did we beat him when he headed to hell for the last time? No, this happens after. Because it emphasizes that we battled twice. So this headed to hell for the last time is going to happen in the next chapter. Okay. So, let me think about what happened. With Gabriel, specifically. So, of course, Gabriel is not happy. We already know this part. Gabriel lost with us for the first time. The council didn't like him, and they sent him back down to undo his mistakes. That's when we lost. Wait, that's when we fought him the second time. Because he's genuinely pissed off at us. And then we fight him again, but then he instantly changes his mind. Not like a, oh my bad, sorry bro, but it makes sense because if you lose twice to something that you thought you had every chance against, then something is wrong. And when that thing happened, you know, he became a different person. It had changed him, as it said. He found himself actually wanting to do something on his own accord, not what was expected of him by the council or God. And because God disappeared, there's nothing for him to look forward to. Because the source of all his desires was with God. And with God gone, he has no more purpose. So now he's left to make his own. Not only that, but, you know, he's obviously starting to doubt the power of holy light. Because that holy light that helped him so many times isn't helping him here. So he's doubting it. That in combination with many other things, like the aforementioned selfish desire. Not selfish in a bad way, but he's finally found something he wants. That in, you know, other reasons, inspired him to betray and kill the rest of the council. Okay. So he was going to say something, but that's going to be saved for next time, I guess. That's probably going to be the first thing that we hear in Fraud. Not Fraud, Violets? Wait, I don't know. It's either Fraud or Violence. But whatever he says might be the first thing we hear when we enter Fraud. Because it said that whatever he said rang out to all the cosmos. Now, I don't know if that was metaphorical or if it's to be taken literally. But I think in Fraud, we're going to hear what he has to say. And the reason that they didn't, that's why Hikita's not letting us know what it is right now. Because we're going to know it later. Now, there's a lot of things that I once thought that's been turned on its head here. So, originally... But instead, what has happened is... Gabriel seems to be turning over a new leaf. I don't know if he'll be buddy-buddy with us, but he's certainly not as hostile as to us as he was before. So he's killed the council. Now the angels truly are lost. Who knows what's going to become of hell? I mean, obviously we're going to rip it to shreds, but very interesting. Will we fight Gabriel again? I don't know. Because it said in the terminal entry that Gabriel heads to hell one last time. That was said after the lore entry repeatedly said that we fought twice. So we may fight a third time. But the lore entry never says he enters hell for a specific reason. He might enter back into hell to be friends. Maybe to just annihilate everything. Maybe because he's about to die. What did the counselor say? He only had a few minutes? Or a few hours? He knows he is going to die. And he's killed the things that were chaining him. So now he is with clear conscience. And he knows his time limit. And it's going down. With that in mind, I wouldn't doubt that he's coming back to hell to slaughter everything, including us, before he dies. Almost like a go out with a bang sort of thing. He's got nothing else to live for. With God dead, the counselor's killed, him beaten twice. What can take down a man with nothing to lose?